Welcome to the how-to video on resolving errors and warnings in LoadComplete tests. During your execution of load tests, LoadComplete may report errors and warnings. Let me explain how you can understand and debug possible causes of these errors or warnings. And for this purpose, I'm going to create a simple load test. First, I'll start by recording a user scenario that our test will use. So I'm going to click on the Record New User Scenario button right here. And that brings up this Create New Project wizard. This wizard assists you in creating a test project that will store your load tests. LoadComplete is asking us to create a new project because there's no currently open project. So on the first page of the wizard, I'm going to type in a name for my project, so diagnose errors, and then I'll click Next. On this screen, I can select the servers whose performance LoadComplete would monitor during the test run. However, I'm not interested in monitoring any server-side metrics in this screencast, so I'm going to leave these fields blank and just click Next. On the final page of the wizard, I'll specify the settings that help you estimate the tested application's performance. So here you can specify a threshold time for request transferring and page loading processes. These applications are set based on the application's specifications. And if a real-time value exceeds the specified value, LoadComplete will report an error. And that will mean that the application doesn't meet the specifications. So I'm going to enter in the desired values and click Finish. So I want 2500 milliseconds for a page load time and 300 milliseconds for a time to first byte. So now LoadComplete has created a new project. And you can see in the background on the left-hand side of my screen, the project contents are being displayed in that Explorer panel. And it's also invoked the Record User Scenario dialog. And here, we can specify a name for our scenario and the name of the test that will be automatically created based on the recorded scenario that we're generating. We can also specify the web page that we're going to be testing. In our case today, we'll just use Google. We can also choose what browser will be used for our load test. And finally, I'm going to disable this option right here because I don't want LoadComplete to clear the browser's cookies and cache before recording the scenario. So now I click Record. You can see here that LoadComplete will automatically launch our desired web page. And now I can perform some actions that I expect users to perform on this site. So I'm going to type in SmartBear into the search box here. All right, and that's everything that I want to do here. And so now I'm going to click Stop. And LoadComplete will save off the recorded traffic in this scenario. Now I'm going to verify the recorded scenario. Verification of the scenario includes a simulation of this scenario for one virtual user and ensuring that the scenario is executed successfully. It's a good practice to verify a recorded scenario for a single virtual user before you create more robust load tests, as verification helps you determine a scenario's bottlenecks and avoid problems which don't relate to the actual volume of virtual users. So to verify a scenario, simply right-click on it and select Verify Scenario. LoadComplete will simulate the scenario with one virtual user. Okay, I fast-forwarded a bit, and now that the verification has been performed, you can see that LoadComplete is displaying the scenario results run on screen. And the summary report here is telling us that there was one warning that was encountered during the course of the run. So to get more information, I can click on this View link, and LoadComplete will bring up the Messages panel of the test log. This panel contains various messages that were posted to the log during the load test run. Here, we can see messages informing us that various requests were completed successfully, and one message that tells us that request number one was completed with warnings. So let's explore and fix this warning. LoadComplete reports warnings when it detects that the server's response code for a given request is different from the code that was recorded. So to determine the cause of a warning, we need to compare the recorded and actual response codes. And you can see those codes over here in the recorded value and simulated value columns of this headers pane. In these panels, we can see that the recorded response code differs from the response code that LoadComplete received during simulation. A 200 message means that the request has succeeded. 302 means that the content is temporarily found at another location. And because the codes differ, LoadComplete has posted a warning to the log. Now, a possible cause of this problem is that we did not clear the browser's cache before recording the scenario. And when the cache isn't clean, then the browser reuses cache data to process client requests instead of sending that data onto the server and receiving responses from the server. However, while running a scenario, LoadComplete doesn't use the cache. It sends requests to and receives responses directly from the server, and this is what's causing the difference between the recorded and the actual response codes. So to avoid such warnings, you need to clear the browser's cache, cookies, and temporary files, and then re-record the scenario. You can choose to clear the cache manually, or you can use the Clear Browser Data button in the Record User Option scenario right here. You can just make sure this box is checked. Now, this approach is meaningful if the log contains multiple warnings of this type. However, in our case, we only have one warning in the log, so we're not going to re-record the scenario. We're going to handle this in a different way. Now, LoadComplete allows you to customize the expected code for given responses, so we can change the expected code so that the actual response will be interpreted as successful in future runs. And to do that, we just right-click on the response header here and say Mark received response as OK. So now LoadComplete will treat any 302 message that this request receives as successful. And we can see the expected response codes by coming back up to the scenario editor here, choosing request 1, and then selecting the general tab. Now you can see here we're going to retreat response 302 as OK. Now you can also manually add other expected codes to the expected HTTP responses list just by right-clicking here and saying new item, and then you can customize whatever response code you're looking for, but I'm just going to remove that one for now. Of course, changing the expected codes isn't a universal remedy. The very same response can be considered as successful in one situation, but it may be regarded as a malfunction in another. As such, you should treat every warning differently and resolve them all individually. To check whether changing the expected response code fixes the warning, I'm going to verify the scenario once more. So again, I'm just going to right click and say verify scenario. Okay, I've fast forwarded a bit, and as you can see, the verification completed successfully. There are no errors or warnings listed in the log as shown right here. So now we can know that LoadComplete is reporting that request number 1 will complete successfully, even though the actual response code is different from the one that we recorded. So now we can create a load test based on the scenario that we just verified. So I've double-clicked on my test node right here, and I'm going to modify this default test to match more what I'm looking for here. So we'll do 30 virtual users to start out with, and I want to emulate a 10 megabit LAN there. And then I'm also going to add another group of virtual users called VU2, and I want 20 users of them, and I want them coming from my workstation at maximum speed. Okay, so now we've got our load test configured and I can run it. So to do that, I just need to click this Run Load Test button right here. Now, unlike verification, the ordinary test run is affected by a number of additional parameters like workload policy, think time, and the quality of service criteria that we specified earlier. And sometimes these additional parameters can cause issues, so don't be surprised if new errors and warnings are introduced. This is normal. Now, while running the load test, LoadComplete monitors a number of server parameters and plots them on the runtime graphs here. For example, this basic quality graph that you see in the top left corner of my screen displays the number of errors and warnings that occurred during simulation. The errors are plotted in the graph in the red color, and the warnings are in yellow. Okay, I fast-forwarded a bit. You can see our test run has finished, and now let's take a look at the messages that were posted to the log here. And as you can see, this test log contains a lot of messages, and it may be overwhelming to find the ones that you're looking for. So to check to see if the event log contains informative error messages, I'll filter the panel's contents simply by unchecking the OK box right here. And now we can see all that's left are these errors. There are no warnings that were logged, but there were several errors that occurred during the test run. Now, all these errors occurred for one reason. The quality of service criteria were violated. So these errors mean that the tested web server isn't operating fast enough. That is, the appropriate requests were simulated successfully, however, the intended response time exceeded the specified quality of service metrics that we entered at the beginning of the test. So now those settings are specified here on the quality of service metrics on the load test editor page here. Now, since these are unchecked, then that means we're using the global settings that are applied at the project level, and those are listed back here on this page. These settings allow you to enter the times that should be spent on traffic simulation. If the actual times exceed the specified threshold time values, LoadComplete posts errors, as we've seen. So the quality of service criteria are set from your own application specifications, so you come up with what those numbers should be. And if those numbers are displayed, then we know that the server isn't performing fast enough and you need to find the cause of the server's poor performance. Once you've resolved the error, you can run the test again to make sure it's fixed. LoadComplete can post errors to the log for various other reasons, not just if the quality of service criteria were violated. For example, it will post errors to the logs when it fails to send requests to the server or if the server failed to respond. So let's talk about errors of this type. I've opened up a new project inside of LoadComplete, and you can see that I'm testing this V32E server. I've already run my load test, and I've received this report. As you can see, this test run has failed because several errors were occurred. Now, this first error takes place right down here, and you can see that the message is that the connection was refused, and as such, some requests that followed weren't actually simulated. You can see here this particular request has recorded values, but no simulated values on replay. That's because the test engine was unable to connect to the tested host. Quite often, the connection refused and host not found errors are occasional errors caused by temporary issues on the server, and in subsequent runs, those errors may disappear all by themselves. To check this, just run the test again. But if you find that the error is persisting, you may need to adjust some server parameters. For instance, you may need to increase the maximum number of simultaneous connections that your server allows. There are situations when LoadComplete does not report any errors or warnings, however you find that the load test isn't running correctly. For example, you may notice your database contains the incorrect data after the test finishes. This can happen when you load test applications that use specific data formats and protocols to communicate with a web server. For example, when you test Flash or Flex applications that use the action message format, the fact is that such applications return error messages not in the form of response codes, but as data within the response contents. So, since the response codes are successful, LoadComplete isn't reporting any errors. So, to illustrate this, I've opened up another LoadComplete project that contains a load test for a Flex application. And as you can see here, the LoadComplete results are saying that everything was successful, there were no errors and warnings. However, I know that something didn't work right. So what I'm going to do is go into the messages panel here. And what I can do is click through my messages that are listed and then click on the bodies tab. And what I want to find is if there are any errors in here. And as you can see, there's a fault string that's been provided inside the response body. And so now we know that something went wrong during the course of our load test. So to find the cause of problems like this during the test run, you can also use other sources of information like web servers logs, your applications logs, and so on. This concludes our video. You've seen the basic principles of resolving errors and warnings in load tests. Certainly, each real-life error and warning would require its own repair technique. However, you can find more information in the LoadComplete documentation that's available on our website at smartbear.com. We wish you luck and hope you enjoy automating your tests with LoadComplete.